first difference, I think, between traditional models for strategy and the way that we think about it today in many, many sectors is we used to think about sustainable competitive advantage as the holy grail for what you wanted your strategy to accomplish. So the idea was you found an attractive position in an attractive industry, you threw up entry barriers like crazy, and then you got to extend that advantage for a really long period of time. And many things went together with that assumption. So the idea that you're protecting, you know, your territory, the idea that your main objective, once you've established a competitive advantage, is defensive. And the idea that you could spend your whole career exploiting a particular advantage. What we're finding today, however, is that more and more sectors of our economy globally have been in a very different mode. That entry barriers have come down, the cost of assets, it's much cheaper, it's very easy to enter different sectors. And so a lot of the things that used to protect competitive advantages from rapid competition have really eroded. So what I'm going to argue is that as leaders of your firms, you really need to be thinking about the whole life cycle of a competitive advantage. So you have the period of time at which it gets created. That's the innovation process, right? Bringing something new into the world. Then indeed, you have this period of exploitation where you get to exploit an advantage that's been created. But then, you know, technologies change, markets shift, customer demand is different, and your advantage begins to go into erosion. And the argument I'm going to make throughout is that as a leader, you need to be very cognizant of all three life cycle stages and how they could be managed. So this chart here is an example of this phenomenon playing out in the gaming business. And in the beginning, you know, in the 70s, we had arcade games, and that's all there was. And you had a physical game, and that was tied to an analog machine. You didn't have such a thing as software powering games back then. So that was the next big revolution. You started to separate out the physical machine on which the game was played from the software that powered the game. Then we had changes in form factors. So you started to have games that could be played on portable devices, you know, games that could be played anywhere, games that could be played any time of the day. Then we started to see revolutions in how people wanted to connect with other gamers. And so we started to see massive multiplayer games. We started to see games that weren't shoot 'em up games, games that were actually about Civilizations or The Sims or whatever. And so what you see is this evolution of how a particular sector changes over time. And as you look at these market share shifts in the gaming business, what you really see is this wave of competitive advantage and how it changes. So the first big idea here is that you need to be thinking about your competitive advantages, not as something that's going to carry you forward for the rest of your career, but as something that needs to be continually reinvented, reinvested in, renewed. And that your job as a leader is to really be thinking about all three of those life cycle phases. And this brings with it what I call a new strategy playbook, where instead of thinking of stability, you know, that sustainability thing, as the normal state, you need to be thinking about change as the normal state. And it's gotten a lot of attention now under the guise of agility or change readiness or change management. I call it continuous reconfiguration, but whatever you call it, it's this idea that you're in motion. And that is a much different idea than the more static views of strategy would have us believe. We also need to get smarter about disengagement. And when I talk about disengagement, what I mean is pulling resources out of an advantage, a business, a position, a brand that is no longer really going to be part of your future. And to be able to do that regularly, but in a healthy way, you know, not this sort of, oh my God, it's awful and it's so painful and people's careers die and it gets shoved under the rug and nobody ever talks about it again. Instead, recognizing this is just a normal part of the business cycle and doing it in a really healthy way. The third dynamic that I think is ever more central to the way that we need to be thinking about strategy today is the question of how do I allocate resources across my whole portfolio? So the first issue is many, especially larger organizations, don't even know what they're investing in, right? They've got all these projects and programs and whatnot, and people have kind of lost track. So do I even know what's in there? Next is a more strategic question, which is, am I appropriately resourcing investments in the core business? Am I building the next generation core business, so the new platforms for the future? And am I investing in strategic options, which are small investments today? They're probably small opportunities today that could be the big opportunity of the future. And so how do I manage that? And how do I really make sure that that happens in a routine way? Then we have innovation. And I would argue the successful organizations of the future have innovation as an actual proficiency. You know, it's not something that happens periodically or, you know, some senior person says, we need more innovation around here. You go form a Skunkworks, you know, go think great thoughts in black t-shirts or whatever it is you need. That's just silly. What we need instead is innovation as an actual process, a proficiency. And everybody thinks the problem is good ideas. The problem is not good ideas. You've been to this conference by now. You have more good ideas than you'll ever be able to execute against. What you really need is proficiency at three things. Yes, of course, getting good ideas. Much more important, taking those ideas and incubating them so that you're walking them through some kind of process, which is going to get them ready to be introduced to some kind of market. And then you have the question of scaling them up. So accelerating the process so that they can actually become fully fledged members of your corporate brotherhood. And so you need those three things. And many, many organizations just don't do it on a routine basis. All of this has enormous implications for leadership because leaders today can't assume they have the answers. So the command and control model of leadership that many of us take for granted really doesn't work in this kind of environment where it's so much more about sense making, building webs of inclusion, getting uncomfortable information, really figuring out what's going on. I refer to that as being more discovery driven as leaders. And finally, we have the question of talent. And more what we're seeing is people are moving into what I call a tour of duty talent structure, where you may work for 5 or 10 organizations over the course of your career. Your career may not even look like careers formerly, where you became a deep expert at something. Instead, you may move from role to role. You may acquire different skills. You may be in different professions. You may be in completely different contexts. And so this notion of a tour of duty puts additional strains on your ability to manage talent. It changes the nature of what your HR department should be doing, and it changes the nature of how you need to be thinking about career progress as you go further. So these are all elements of what I call the new strategy playbook. It's really as much about a new mindset and ways of behaving as it is about any specific technique or tool. It's an approach. So let's dig into this a little bit more and connect it with this notion of strategic inflection points, because I think this is where a lot of otherwise smart and sensible organizations get stuck. So I write about this in my most recent book, which was called Seeing Around Corners, How to Spot Inflection Points in Business Before They Happen. And an inflection point, as Andy Grove taught us many, many years ago, is something that occurs typically in your external environment that exerts a 10x force on something about your business. So it changes the technology, or it changes the regulatory structure, or it changes the permissions society's given you. Whatever it is, it's going to change something fundamental about your business. Now, the reason this matters is that any organization, and all of you are affiliated to some extent with an organization, grows up at a particular moment in time when certain things are possible and certain things are not. And what emerges as you develop a recipe for success is a whole constellation of practices, metrics, beliefs, regulatory regimes that reinforce whatever was the recipe for success at that time. So to take an example, if I had said to you 25 years ago, you know, YouTube would come along and completely change the nature of how we think about media, how we access our audiences, how we build audiences. And in fact, if somebody had said you could get a video message to literally millions of people in a fraction of a minute for zero cost, you'd have looked at them and said, you're nuts. Because our view of what happens in economies happens as a function of what was possible at that moment. So what an inflection point does is it changes that equation. It says, no, now you can do something 10 times cheaper, 10 times faster, 10 times better, 10 times more conveniently. And the incumbent existing players really struggle to connect to that. It's a very challenging idea. And we can see players getting taken by surprise all the time. A great example of this is, and some of you may be in these businesses, the whole notion of direct-to-consumer businesses rather than going through conventional retail channels. And this has been incredibly destabilizing to a lot of businesses that sell to consumers. Why? Because now instead of going through my aggregating retail channel, now I've got to deal with hundreds of thousands or even millions of individual customers, each of whom have their quirks and their curiosities. Now, for the players that are willing to lean into this, and this is something fascinating about inflection points, your business can take new heights. For the players that sort of dig in their heels or don't want to see it or don't want to talk about it, it can eventually cause your business to decline. So in the direct consumer space, a really interesting example is Nike, that basically said, look, we want to own our relationship with our consumers. We're completely getting rid of our retail structure with a few key exceptions. We're not going to go through general retailers. If you want to buy Nike products, you're coming to us, and we're going to have a relationship with you. And their direct-to-consumer channel has been an incredible vector for growth. But of course, it's left the sporting goods retailers and the department stores and all the others sort of reeling with this change. So I think this notion of inflection points is quite easy because it can really change the competitive dynamics on which you depend. And so if you take a company like Procter & Gamble in the shaving or personal grooming sector, they had a competitive advantage that lasted for decades, specifically in their Gillette business, right, which makes, by and large, men's shavers. They went from 70% market share to about 59%. And a lot of that was due to the incursion of these direct-to-consumer players. So organizations like Dollar Shave Club and Harry's, telling younger men, you don't have to do this. Like, you don't have to go to the department store or the drugstore and buy razors, which are super expensive, and get somebody to like unlock the laser fortress for you. And who needs that stuff, right? We'll just send them straight to your door. Super convenient, super easy, really appeals to a much different demographic than the core sort of Gillette shaver. And so it can really create enormous change in the assumptions that you make about your industry. So this really brings me to the question of where are you competing? And a big idea in the book, and a big idea for a lot of organizations, is that we're really going from a world where your industry predicted an enormous amount of what was going to happen to you strategically to a world where instead you're competing in arenas to the point where the most significant competitor you face may not even be in your own industry. It might be some other industry affecting the dynamics of what happens in yours. So broadening your thinking from industry to arenas, I think, is a super important idea. And one concept that will serve you well in this arena-based competition mode is something I call jobs to be done. So it was a concept that was popularized by Clayton Christensen. It's used by Tony Ulwick. And basically what they're saying is, customers may buy certain offerings, certain goods, certain services, whatever. But what they want is an outcome, right? So in the case of a skateboard, right, what are you buying? Well, you're buying polyurethane wheels and titanium hardware and that kind of stuff. What do you want? You want the feeling of being able to fly on your skateboard. It's a very different way of looking at the same thing. And what I find happens to a lot of organizations is they get so anchored on what they do, what format they use, what products they sell, what's the underlying technology, that they get completely absorbed by that and they forget what the customer need is that they want to get done. So let me take an example, which hopefully will bring this to life a little bit. So the customer that I'm thinking about is teenagers, and the category is clothing. So let's think a little bit about teenagers and what is the job that clothing does for teenagers. Well, it's going to be really different than the job clothing did, say, for my mother. My mother's definition of great clothing was it should be very durable. It should resist stains. It shouldn't wrinkle. It should last through multiple wash cycles. It should be great value. And it should be available at, a mid-market retailer like JCPenney's or something. When you look at teenagers, that's not why they buy clothing. Clothing has an enormous communication component for teenagers. So, who am I? Who am I not? What tribe do I belong to? How cool am I? Am I attracting attention or deflecting attention? What sort of image do I want to project to the world? So clothing has, in addition to its functional attributes, it's got this incredibly important communicational job to do. Now, if we think about teenagers, and this is a phenomenon that really got started in about 2003, when cameras first became included in conventional cell phones, being teenagers, you know, as soon as you have two teenagers with cameras, what are they doing? They're sending pictures to each other, right? Very normal teenage behavior. Now, let's connect this to clothing. So I'm sending someone a cool photo of myself at a party, you know, and I'm in a blue outfit. And 3 days later, I've got a photo of myself in another cool setting and I've got the same outfit on. And then, you know, maybe a week later, you know, you get the idea that what teenagers want is the perfect Instagram or whatever the equivalent technology is, the perfect social media picture. And then the clothes need to change. They need to be different because for the next picture, I want to look different. I want a different style. And this is, to me, one major contributor of the whole fast fashion movement, which has really overtaken a lot of the fashion business, especially in the younger demographics. So who's succeeding? It's companies like Zara and H&M, you know, that have really been able to turn their styles around much more quickly. They don't stock too much of anything in one store. They've got a buy it now, you know, you might not be here tomorrow if you hesitate kind of vibe about them. Very, very popular with teenagers, rocketing growth. And who's really suffering? It's the conventional retailers, right? The conventional apparel people that have four seasons a year, and we ship it all from Asia. And at the beginning of the season, we charge our highest prices. And at the end of the season, we sell everything off for bargain basement rates. Well, if you're in a continuous flow, I always want to have something new kind of mode, you're not going to be particularly successful in that world. And you can see the consequences, right? So this is a graph of revenue at U.S. department stores, which in addition to this sort of long-running inflection point, have had to deal with e-commerce, the decline of the downtown, shifting buyer preferences and demographics. And a lot of department stores look exactly the way they did, you know, 40 years ago. And so they've really just, especially given the pandemic now, just fallen completely off a cliff. Who's doing really well? Companies like Ross Stores, you know, where it's a treasure hunt. And it's a well-priced treasure hunt. You never know who's going to be in there. So not only can you get clothing and other things that you really want there, but it's fun. It's a fun shopping experience. So a very different model than the traditional model. So, you know, who's competing in clothing? Well, you know, think about it. Your cell phone, cameras, selfies, maybe even Instagram is a big factor in your competitive dynamics. So broaden your scope about how you think about who's competing. And the depth to which this has gotten now is only exacerbated by the current COVID moment, to the point where the New York Times had this cover under Sunday magazine, sweatpants forever. So not only are we not buying apparel, you know, the kind of apparel we're buying is not geared to working outside the home. You know, it's all comfort stuff that we use when we're working from home. And you can see this also in the consequences for large established retailers catering to business wear. You're seeing, for example, Brooks Brothers declaring bankruptcy. You're seeing dry cleaning shops. Nobody's doing dry cleaning because nobody's wearing business clothes outside. Shoes, you know, people are not wearing dress up high heel shoes to do what they need to do on a very basic level. So, you know, you've got all these things working together to create this quite unstable industry sector. So let me conclude with a couple of observations. The first observation is that when I first started in strategy, everybody was talking about industry, and everybody was talking about neutral tendencies, memes, and variations. And they were looking at industries that existed, customers that existed, business models that existed, and everything was very much around this notion of stable average performance. Those of us studying innovation, we were, you know, off in a corner huddled for warmth because we were studying the insides of companies. We were studying what made them different and idiosyncratic. And other people were studying sectors and industries and what made them the same, right? Very different. So I think what's happened in the intervening years as this notion of a life cycle of competitive advantage has become much more critical to people is innovation is now squarely part of the strategy conversation. So you can't really talk about strategy these days without some nod to innovation, new market creation. How are we going to stay on top? And increasingly, and this is quite relevant for those of you attending Shift, that has a digital component to it. So it's not just innovation, but it's also innovating business models, innovating practices, you know, innovating around things that are now abundant that used to be scarce. So it's a big moment, I think, for these three things to come together. And that's really where a lot of my work these days is focusing, this intersection between strategy, innovation, and digital. So some final thoughts. I think we're really going from a notion of stability to a notion where change has got to be more comfortable. And it's probably more organic, and it's probably less bureaucratic than the way we've continually thought about change in the past. So Gary Hamel, for example, has a great book out called Humanocracy, about how deadly bureaucracy is in stifling innovation and initiative, and talking about change as something that can be embraced, not as something that's sort of horrible and destabilizing. I would say disengagement. Very important. You need to be able to stop making investments that are not going to be useful in the future. And in parallel with that, resource allocation, absolutely critical. Absolutely critical. Innovation, as I've just argued, needs to be a proficiency. We have to have that. New pressures on leaders. Leaders can't just get up and tell people what to do anymore because they don't know. We're all in such an uncertain situation. Our job is mainly discovery, not orders, making orders. Think about arenas rather than industries. And I believe that because inflection points don't happen instantly, they feel as though they do, but they really don't. They usually have been coming along, brewing along for quite some time. And I argue that you can systematically identify the early warnings that big changes may be afoot. And that gives you the opportunity to get on the right side of that curve rather than being on the dark side. So if you'd like a deeper dive, please get in touch, stay in touch. I'm on Twitter and LinkedIn. Those are probably my two most populated social media channels, although I'm on all of them. I have a YouTube channel as well. I do monthly newsletters, which are free. You just need to go to my website and subscribe. And for now, I'm doing a whole series of fireside chats, typically on a Friday. They are free. They're webinars. So feel free to look them up again on my website. Join me at any of them that you would like. And I'm here if you have any further questions. Thank you so much.